And does it show that you love the Senate or you love me more? Or because I'm the chairman of the Committee on Finance, and all state universities and colleges should know that we have an across the board 5 million pesos per capital outlay for all SUCs. How many SUCs did not know about it until I said that? See? That's the problem. Sometimes government agencies or maybe the DTM did not communicate it clearly. And last year in 2016, I think there was a 2 million across the board capital outlay. Kaya lang sa huli palagi, if you want it early, please submit it today. Actually, this is a budget meeting, not a climate change commission meeting. Yeah. I just wanted to test you whether you would come if I say climate change, but we can talk budget. Okay. No, but that's actually related, okay? I just wanted to catch your attention this morning, and I'm happy to see all of you. I apologize for being 20 minutes delayed because I was expecting it. Rachel, and she gave me the wrong schedule. It's Rachel. Yes, because I was expecting a early morning call, which I waited. There was the time zone of VT Gore, Climate Reality, Mario Molina. There was supposed to be a conference call on carbon pricing. And the 7 a.m. call, which I waited till 8 o'clock, like a change of time pala because of the time difference. So I'm blaming Attorney Rachel Herrera for being here. Okay. But anyway, I'm happy to be here with you today. First, because I really like to work with our state universities and colleges, because you really form and mold the youth of our country. And you and your brilliance and your wisdom and your network and your grassroots base on the next generation, the youth of our country, is what we need to be able to help the people, local communities, and local governments to build capacity for local climate change action plan. I am not the expert, it's Yusek Panadero, who has been with me much, much longer in government. I think when I was in grade school, he was already in the DILG. So, we will listen later to Yusek Panadero. I'm sure Sek Sueno would have wanted to be here. I saw him 2 days ago when I was in another forum, and he's really very supportive of all our events. And I also am quite, not quite, I'm very, very enthused and inspired this morning because I think magpalakpakan tayo. Imagine we are able to ratify the Paris Agreement against all odds, and despite, you know, I'm sure there were those climate deniers or those who wanted to slow it down, or maybe just apathetic, ignorant, innocent institutions, people who may not agree with everything that we do. But in the end, what is important is that the president wholeheartedly supported it, especially with his elegantly written, give him a copy, I think, don't think it's confidential, the one-page letter of the president when he fully committed to the Paris Agreement and said it should be well below 2 degrees Celsius and committed to the 1.5 degrees that the Philippines had worked so hard for in the Paris Agreement. I want to see the Climate Change Commission clapping their hands. Yes, because sometimes you're quite benign. And I would like the Climate Change Commission, face here, Commissioner Noel. Yes, I would like to see an inspired, converged, cooperative, supportive Climate Change Commission. Do I have it from the three commissioners? Yeah, it's about time. Okay, don't act like squabbling senators, right? Okay, I'm just kidding, no. For those who don't know me, that's just sometimes my sense of humor. In fact, they say sometimes, "Paano ka naman si Presidente? Magsalita, kulang na lang yun." What I'm saying is that just to sometimes make people laugh, nagbibiro lang ako, huwag po niyong mamasamain yung aking biro, ha? Climate Change Commission. Imagine, this is a commission I gave birth to. It was a dream in 2007, enacted into law in 2009, and operationalized in 2011. And now the commission, yes, young, yes, struggling, yes, we need shepherding, and that's the reason why it's being held in the Senate, with our state universities and colleges. And so thank you all for being here. As I said, I would like to greet all of you a triumphant and hopeful and inspired morning. Triumphant because, as I said earlier, we have ratified the Paris Agreement following the President's signing of the Instrument of Accession. Sometimes I have to explain what is a process so simple and basic to me, since I have been here in the Senate since 1998. But sometimes, of course, I should not assume that everybody understands the process of ratification. So just allow me to go through it. On April 22, it was signed, then by Secretary Pahe in New York, and we were there. And that administration had to secure the more than 30 certificates of concurrence from the departments and agencies. Elections happened in May. And in July 1st, the new government had to appoint its cabinet members, and all of these agencies had to do everything again. So to be fair to the administration, the seeming delay was not brought about by reluctance, but really because of circumstances. They say, why was Fiji able to ratify immediately? Why were other nations able to submit their instruments of accession, and therefore they were not just observers in Marrakesh? Because we had elections in the middle and there was a new government, and the others don't go through the same process of ratification as we do. They don't have 33 certificates of concurrence that are needed, because it's an internal policy, it's not even a law that the DFA had instituted, so that there's a whole of society approach. So that, wala magsabi, bakit yung pinasukan yan? Hindi namin alam yan ha? Hindi namin kaya yan ha? Ano ba yan? Hindi. Because all agencies, from agriculture to education, from health to foreign relations, from energy to local government. And so, we are happy that we've been supported. We've had the cooperation. We were able to help secure the unanimous concurrence, not just of the Senate, but of all the departments and agencies of government. And we're hopeful because through this gathering, we're taking a vital step towards achieving the goal of a climate resilient country, thereby contributing to building a resilient Earth. Let me just go straight to the point. Our goal is to limit warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius to survive and to thrive. Yes, it's ambitious. And why would we not, right? Why should we gun for 3 degrees or 5 degrees, even if we are above 1 degree now? Because we have to gun for the highest, because we are one of the most vulnerable, so that we compel the industrialized nations who cost it all to be part of that 1.5 scenario. Whether or not we are a vulnerable country, but we are, the Philippines can significantly contribute to achieving that goal in terms of greenhouse gas reductions, as well as adaptation. This has been said many times. Our GHG emission is very minute, at less than 1%. Even if we become 100% carbon neutral. In fact, others said, let's be carbon negative. I would like to be a carbon negative person. Not a negative person, a carbon negative, okay? Or an office, wouldn't it be nice? In fact, I will put it in the General Appropriations Act, if it's not already in 2017, that every state, university, and college will measure their GHG emissions and just see whether we are able to meet our own targets. There's nothing wrong with measuring that and knowing how much is our carbon footprint contribution in our community, in the country, and in the world. So it is also true that the world is watching our every move, because we have become the face of climate vulnerability. That's very clear to us. We have become, for bad and for good, the poster boy of climate change. But we can actually seize that opportunity of vulnerability, of seeming hopelessness and helplessness, so that people will actually learn from us and help us. The Philippines is an important voice in climate talks, as we have. From a time of former Senator Alvarez, who's been very active in supporting us here, to the time the commission was created, and to the new commissioners. The world listens to us. We are regarded the leader of the vulnerable, the champion for climate justice, which the president has been advocating for so long. So when he was saying this from the start, di naman tayo ang dahilan nito, pero bakit tayo kailangan sumali dito? What he was pushing was the conversation on the issue of climate justice, which I've been advocating, not years, for decades. And so the president was right all along, and he just wanted to tickle the imagination of our people and of the world that, and stress the point, we are non-emitter. But why are you then telling us to mitigate and to adapt? But mitigation as a function, adaptation, that's good for us, and eventually the ratification. Now that we have ratified the climate agreement, we can now influence the decisions on how the accord will be implemented, and we maintain our leadership in international climate talks and advocacy. Yes, the Philippines, as I said, may be insignificant insofar as its contributions to GHG emissions are concerned, and so are 100 other countries. But if a vulnerable developing nation can lead the resilient path, many others would surely follow. In short, if we say, hindi man tayo kailangan kasi maliit lang tayo dito. But if all those small countries and put them together, we would be a big contributor. So that's not the attitude. It's the same thing sometimes with ecological solid waste, not in my backyard, let's not do it, etc. We're a small community, but if we, that's our attitude, then where do we put our solid waste? So regardless if we are vulnerable, small emitter or not, this is the right way to go. We've already proven this when we enacted climate change law, which has been regarded by the UNISDR, along with the NGMC, as model legislation in the world. And what we need to do is just to prove that our laws work, to fund it, to provide the experts and the people, and to operationalize all the good intentions of the law. We're also happy that we helped in spearheading the Climate Vulnerable Forum. Not many people know the little story, which is not too little, on how the CVF started. Maybe not even the members of the CVF know. It was on a UNISDR mission to Maldives in 2009, on my second term, when I met with then Maldives President Nasheed. His first name is Muhammad Nasheed. He is an environmentalist president of the small island state, beautiful but troubled. He even held a cabinet meeting amid corals underwater. Yes. I don't think the president would do that. Maybe he could do it to Bataan. Yes. So I gave President Nasheed a concept note on how we vulnerable nations can actually have a voice. And we were thinking of another friend of his, Nobel laureate, then President, Timor-Leste President, Ramos Horta. And he said, okay, let's create a group. Timor-Leste, Indian people, Maldives, and then the Philippines. At the time, we were not 100 here, maybe at the time, 85, 90, okay, let's go. And I gave him a concept note, which was actually drafted by the ISDR with Jerry Velasquez, soon joining the Green Climate Fund, and Manny Guzman, who was with ISDR. We were with the UN group. And to make a long story short, I not taught them, gave them my inputs on legislation that can be done. So his cabinet was there, there were parliamentarians. He took it seriously and eventually created the Climate Vulnerable Forum with the UNDP as secretariat. So what happened to me? I was not part of the original group because, first, I'm not a head of state. Second, crazy me, I run for political office in 2010. And that's what I always say privately, but I'll tell you now, politics got in the way. If politics did not get in the way, I was probably part, I would have been part of that, not even Troika, but Maldives and the Philippines founding or starting, because it actually originated for me during that visit. But never mind, he's very good. And he took it seriously and created it. And now, that talk and that UN visit created the CDF, which is 43 countries. How many are the members of the CDF now, Bernice?
47.
Okay, 47? Yes. From 2 to 3 to 4 to 20, and now 47. So that's the little story there. Not to claim the credit, it's just the facts of the story. So 2009, and now in 2017, we have 43. And the ministers of finance were very excited about this. And we're talking about climate finance. And so the V20 was born with our former Secretary Cesar Purisima also embracing the issue of climate finance, and Secretary Dominguez also being very excited about it. And so they created the Vulnerable 20 Group of Ministers of Finance, or V20, which works to address climate change more assertively through innovative financing and technology, among many other initiatives. So why am I telling you all this? So that you, leaders, and brilliant minds of our state universities and colleges would really understand part of my climate journey. And that's not even a drop in a bucket of the whole story. One day I'll lock you in this and another one microphone and just ramble. You can ask me all the questions, because it started way beyond 2009, way beyond 2007. It started way beyond before 1998, when I became senator. Victoria was one of my staff when she started, and she was a new graduate, and she knows part of that story. The test of true leadership is measured on the ground. It is not enough that we are the voice of the vulnerable in the global arena. It is even more important that our own people, our climate engaged, our communities are gearing towards the sustainable path. While Section 14 of Republic Act 9729, or as I said, the Climate Change Act of 2009, provides that LGUs will be the frontline agencies in the formulation, planning, and implementation of climate change action plans in the respective areas. Section 16 of the same law also calls for them to coordinate with various sectors, including the academe, in the development and the implementation of the LCCAPs, or the Local Climate Change Action Plan. So on my second term, when I was writing this bill to be enacted into law, and there was much opposition then from some members of the chamber who were climate deniers or who simply wanted to block an important piece of legislation. In fact, if you go to the archives and see that name, some said, that's not needed because it's covered by environment. That's not needed because it's agriculture. There was some resistance to create first the standing committee and second the oversight committee on climate change and the climate change law. But what happened? Sometimes when nature listens, it unleashes its fury and something serendipitous happens. What do I mean? Ondoy happened and flooded Metro Manila, Central Luzon, and Calabarzon. And some of my colleagues said, ito pala ang sinasabi ng batang ito, ng babaeng ito. So this is what she's been talking about all along. And so, agad-agaran, they calendared it, and the climate change law was enacted. Of course, I'm simplifying, perhaps embellishing part of it, but that's part of the story. When something happens, unfortunately a tragedy, the policy is better understood. It was also the Payatas tragedy that led to the enactment in my first term of one of my first laws, which is the Ecological Solid Waste Management Law, which was rotting for 3 years in the archives. And a landslide, crash line happened, which killed people, families, And then they said, this is what she means, that we should outlaw open dumps, that we should segregate garbage at source, recycle, and compost. And so the Ecological Solid Waste Management Law was the first law signed by then President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo in January 2001, when I filed it in 1998. So the Payatas tragedy was the awakening of the Ecological Solid Waste Management Law, and Ondoy led to the awakening of minds to the importance of the Climate Change Act. So this is where the role of state universities and colleges becomes very crucial. We need to fast track the creation of local climate change action plans of our cities, our municipalities, our provinces. In fact, I would like to add, barangays, the smallest political unit, sitios, right? If we have energization of sitios, why don't we do action plans to the sitio level and use the network of the NEA and of the electric cooperatives? Because we need to have resilient energy infrastructure as well. And we need the whole network of LGUs and of state universities and colleges. These LCCAPs can be the tools to access grant-based funding. Another law which I authored and then sponsored, it was Senate President Enrique then, who was a principal author, was the People Survival Fund. There's a little story to this. It was a provision already part of the climate change law. Unfortunately, in some Senate deliberation, some senators wanted it taken out because they wanted to dilute the Climate Change Act. Pagbigyan ako, isa batas, pero walang funding. Sometimes, you really just have to fight the battle, but two steps backward and agree, and then file it elsewhere. Kumalag ako, it was enacted into law. And then, I filed the People's Survival Fund, that provision excised from the law, and then worked on it. And years later, it was enacted into law, okay, put it together, Siamese twins, it's complete. That's life. You can't get it all at one time in one blow. The Climate Change Act created a commission, the People's Survival Fund, it even turned out better, has a board with the Department of Finance. On the first year, they gave zero funding. Second year, zero. Third year, 500. Then 1 billion. And then another year, 1 billion. But I must, hindi ko pa ipapagalitan ngayon, Climate Change Commission, even the previous group, please spend it. Of course, it's not for them to spend. It's for the DOF and the whole board to really assess the grants. Who's in charge among the three of you? Commissioner Noel? Yes, and the DOF. So, just put it in your website. It's already there. It's already there. What is your website that they can go to? climate.gov.ph. Please go to, not now, you listen to me 2 minutes. Okay. climate.gov.ph, so you can learn to access the People Survival Fund so that state universities are not barred from accessing it, right? They can. It must be accreditation by the LGU. So local governments, state universities and colleges, even people's organizations can be accredited by the local government. You work in the local government. I would be so happy if all 113 state universities and colleges, pagalingan ng proposal, ang gagaling ng mga utak niyo eh. At saka, all your needs are there. If you could help out and have your own proposals. I think one or two have already accessed it. A municipality in Surigao, Del Carmen, and Lanuza in Mindanao. So I'm happy it was Mindanao that accessed it. Perhaps, do we have state universities in Caraga present here today? Caraga, yes. Maybe you can visit Lanuza and Del Carmen. Mayor Coro, yes. And see what they did. And the winning proposal based on the grant is a climate school. A climate school. It would be interesting. So you can even, maybe you could upload in the website the proposal that made it so they can see, ah, ganito pala. But it doesn't mean it has to be all climate schools. Baka makita naman kasi sa lahat 113 SUCs, the proposal from climate school. So it could be anything and anything. And the TOR is there in the climate.gov website, right? It should be there. What's the terms of reference? What are the requirements? All of that. So please access it because I made it zero budget this year. Because they have not spent the 2 billion pesos. But I will give you much more. Believe me, Climate Change Commission, listen to me. I will allocate in 2018 if I see 2 billion funds moving this year. You'll be surprised, you will not even need to go to the Green Climate Fund because I will give you the PSF, all the funding needed. I want to see the PSF swamped with proposals from local governments, CSOs and POs and NGOs, and especially state universities and colleges, because you're the ones who would be quick and who would know how to do these proposals. So, no less than the DILG, through its several department circulars, have acknowledged the vital role played by the academy, and I would quote, as service providers in terms of training on disaster risk reduction and climate change adaptation related concerns, hazard mapping, risk and vulnerability assessment. As part of its capacity building for LGUs, the DILG has continuously embarked on the training of select state universities and colleges on climate and disaster risk assessment. Perhaps if I may suggest, Yusek Panadero is a local government academy present here today. Yes. So the local government academy, sana sinama natin ang judicial academy, did we invite them? CJ Sereno even asked me, can you please teach? We need our judges and prosecutors, kailangan nila eh. But maybe we train the SUCs first, or the SUCs will help train first. So as part of its capacity building for LGUs, the DILG has done all these trainings, and through the local government academy, I think, you've formed an academic consortium with one institution per region. Is that accurate? Yes. And with that consortium, it will serve as a knowledge hub, and I quote, to develop and professionalize local disaster risk reduction and management offices, and to provide local governments with scientific data and pools of local disaster experts and practitioners. I'd like to see all the 1,634 local governments with a DRR officer who is not just para ni mayor o inappoint para lang mag-comply, hindi. Talaga yung DRR engaged. And if the SUCs can also help in the appointment of that person, or if the appointed person can be made competent, or capacity can be built with the help of SUCs. Kaya, pag climate genius ang mga SUC, and you are all over the country, kayo na ang magiging viral na yun sa community. Kaya nga ang susi SUC, kayo ang aking mga foot soldiers, eco-warriors. We know that the vulnerability and risk profile of each community is different. That's very clear. Yet we cannot disregard how the vulnerability and risk profile of a region, province, city, or municipality would affect that community. In other words, there are clearly no political boundaries when it comes to disaster risks and climate change impacts. Thus, the need for the intervention of the SUCs in formulating and enhancing these local plans. Alam natin naman mga ilog at mga lawa at mga bundok. Bundok ng Sierra Madre mula sa norte hanggang aabot hanggang Marikina watershed. So hindi pwedeng political boundaries o distrito ni congressman o ito lang yung municipality ni mayor. NSUCs know that. With the available historical and cultural information that you already have and the technical expertise for research and development, you will give the heart and soul to these action plans. Huwag lang natin gawing climate, environment, parte ng klima ay ang karunungan ukol sa kabihasnan ang ating kultura, especially that we're populated with a population of more than 10 million indigenous people. And many of you, Caraga, Cordillera, in every region, we have our IPs. So cultural interventions is important in even doing our local climate change action plan. We have to work together. All of you, as I said, can become our climate warriors. Small towns around the world are already doing their share in the fight against climate change. You can just Google this. I'll mention I'll just note. I see you say. Greensburg in Kansas, Built Back Better. It was flattened by a tornado in 2007. I'm just calling this, now this is not first-hand info. It's now running on 100% renewable. In the village of Kalisan in Java, Indonesia, tofu businesses used to throw away the water they used to create tofu. The liquid used to contaminate local water supplies until they turned it into tofu biogas, how interesting, which could replace 16,000 tons of fossil fuel a year. In the small British town of Ashton Hayes, residents are working together to make their community carbon neutral through lifestyle changes such as taking fewer flights, using clotheslines instead of dryers. Oh, you back to basics, iba sampayan. Di kailangan na dryer, ako di ako nag-dryer, sampayan ako. And improving the insulation of their homes, shrinking their total carbon footprint by 40% so far. The Philippines has so many best practices to share. November last year, the Climate Change Consciousness Week, the Climate Change Commission announced the winners of the inaugural Climate Adaptive and Disaster Resilient Awards for cities and municipalities. Did you upload that on your website, Climate Change Commission? All the winners of the CLAD? It should be there. So that, you know, first they're proud. Second, they could be the stewards or the champions in their communities. Third, ito assignment ni yung tatlo, tell your secretariat. All the CLAD winners, bilang kasasalamat naman sa atin at may premyo sila, they should choose a municipality they will mentor. Nanalo sila for something. To share the best practices among themselves. Kung yung isa, bihasa sa agrikultura, isa, bihasa sa early morning, hindi naman lang eksperto sa lahat eh. So they share. So natuto si agrikultura sa early morning at sa reforestation at sa mangroves. So lahat yan. So pag sama-sama mo yung alam nila, yun na yun ang isa-share nila at lahat dapat sila. At kung ayaw sumunod sa inyo, susunod yun sa akin. Kasi para sa kabutihan nila yan. Ine-mentor nila, ipili sila ng isang neighboring LGU. Tapos, dapat alam ng SUC na pinakamalapit sa kanila ang kanilang gawa. Ako rin, lahat. Although nandun naman yun. Para ma-share. So the SUC can learn from the local governments or even the local communities and can make it a model. Because nanalo na nga sila eh. They've been doing it. I just remember it was mayor ng Sosokon. Sabi ko. Anyway, so these 10 local government units were awarded for implementing innovative strategies to manage climate and disaster risks in line with the environmental laws. Oh, these are the LGUs. Kanaman, Kamsur, Carbona, Cavite, Dumangas, Iloilo, Hinatuan, Surigao Sur, Legazpi, Albay, Malolos, Bulacan, New Lucena, Iloilo, Palompon, Leyte, or Sucon City, yes, Kisali, at Chicago, Fly, Benguet. So all of these can share with each other and with the SUCs and gather what does Tublay know that Carmona can use? What does Dumangay, what can it do to help Legazpi and Manolos can help New Lucena? Lahat yan. So, ang homework mo, Beth. So, look at all of these 10 and then iwan ko kayo, o want to tell you, anong lahat ginagawa ng sampung ito kung nanalo sila dahil sa tatlo na magaling? 3 times 10, 30 yan ang magagaling. I'm sure may kulang pa yan. Bigayin mo sa akin na memo, yung magagaling na ginagawa nila, believe me, I will find something na hindi ko na naisip. Ilalagay ko yung alam ko, limited edition lang yan, yung alam mo, alam ninyo, para mas maganda. Yan ang ating Biblia for Climate Adaptation. And then, we will spread it to all the SUCs. They're brighter than us. They know much more than us. They've been there longer than us. And they feel it. They've bothered it. They know that. They've studied it. So we'll tell them to even improve on it. Believe me. With that, with the LGU's input and the Climate Change Commission and my office and then the SECs, you have a handbook on climate resilience. See? Okay. So it's really dangerous when you meet with me of many homework. But this homework really is for everyone, right? So these examples only show that we can all be part of efforts to fight climate change, no matter how small. How small? You might think, Senador Ruta, puro national, international, global ang pinag-uusapan. Hindi po. I'm a weekend farmer. I walk my talk. In fact, in the Senate LBRMO, the one who does your budget, don't call me senator. They have a name for me. What do they call me? You know? Rachel, shout it out. I'm not hiya what they call me here. They didn't call me senadora. The Senate Legislative Budget Office, Attorney Doblon, who's been in budget for 40 years, was wondering when I became chairman of finance 2 years ago, my 50 special provisions and email it to all the SUCs. Gulayan sa paaralan, water catchments, the biodiversity mapping, every barangay should have a bamboo and mangrove reforestation, reforestation of mangroves, and the planting of coconut palms as a natural wind buffer. And then I brought them on location, not to barangays, to sitios, and talk to kagawans. And then they were talking behind my back. I said, ano sinasabi sa akin? Nakatawa sila, si Senadora. Hindi senadora, kapitana, diba? So they call me kapitana. I just feel insulted. Of course, I said, because the implementation of all my laws goes down to the grassroots. If you do not understand the problem, not even of the governor and the mayor, of the barangay captain and kagawads and the local communities, you will not understand how life is in the provinces. For 35 years, I've been going around the country, up to Sibuto in Tawi-Tawi, up to the northest, up to the smallest, which is the smallest LGU in the country. May premio. The smallest municipality in the country, no senator has been there. I went there on a New Year's Day. I wish I could remember the name, though. That's why I'm asking you. Huh? No? You should know. The tip of the country is Batanes. So it is whoever can tell me which is that, I will give you a special budget for capital outlay for a research, for a science laboratory. For a science lab, we will build a science laboratory. Ay, nako, ano ba naman kayo? Okay. Ay, nag-google na kayo, ha? Bawal na kayo. No cheating. See? Okay? Iba na. In Batanes. I went to Batanes and went to Iba na with less than 1,000 people. I think 900 at the time, they said. Kulang sila. May naglalakasan ka po kami, Loren Legarza. Kayo ba yan? Hindi, kapatid ko. On a New Year's Day, and they said no, of course no president, no senator has been here. So what am I trying to say? We have to go local. We have to go low, because they're the ones who understand the vulnerability, and they're the ones who understand and who know the, not the high tech, but the very basic climate adaptation and resilience programs, traditional from not just indigenous people, yung mga sinaulan na alam ng ating mga pamilya, lolo, lola. At yun ang ating dapat i-perpetuate, di ba? Hindi ba kailangan palagi bumili ng makina? Sa Bangladesh na, red flags ang ginagamit eh. Iba nga, kling-kling-kling mga bell eh. So at the end of the day, it's not just technology, while it is needed. It's not just finance, which is also needed. But creativity, passion, and innovation. In fact, my very important bill was just passed on second reading yesterday. It's an original bill, which is an output of a 2015 APEC. I'm very proud of it as a principal author of the Innovation Act. Senator Sherwin Kachalian, Economic Affairs Chair, sponsored it. It was passed on second reading yesterday, soon to become a law. And that will be another meeting with SECs. I will make you the champions of innovation, because that is the way forward. And And the Climate Change Commission will also be part of that. So the more important thing is to show the world that even in the midst of tragedies, we can fuel optimism. Even if we are vulnerable, we are not incapable. Even if we are victims, we can also be victors. So let us triumph over this climate battle so that we ignite hope, not only for our fellow men, but also for the future generations. Pasensya na po, napahaba, maraming kwento, pero that means I'm inspired, because when I don't speak long, that means I'm in a bad mood or naaasara po sa inyo. If I don't speak long, but if I speak long, that means I like the energy in the room. And because dahil sa budget meeting, diba, dami senador, daming tanong. Oh, minsan nagagalit, minsan ganyan. Oh, tapos, I cannot really talk to you. But now, I'd like to listen to you. And I will give the floor to Yusek Panadero, who will also tell us how the DILG can work with the state universities and colleges. Chen is also here. Thank you for your patience in listening to me. I hope that I have shared with you. Sana na-infect na kayo ng aking passion. Okay? And yes? Yes. Are we all committed? Yes. Are all the state universities and colleges committed to help our local governments?
Yes.
In climate change adaptation plans for LGUs?
Yes.
And louder.
Yes.
Thank you. Is the Climate Change Commission one in supporting local climate action plan, and will start behaving and cooperating and fully supporting?
Yes.
The Bibang tapos, yes na. Okay. Yeah, I'm your mother, so I, diba? Parents can never go wrong, diba? When I'm your mother, just follow me, and the path we will tread is towards the path of a resilient future. Thank you very much, and good morning.